you take your Bible this morning and turn to the book of Mark, chapter number 6. Mark, chapter number 6. Looking around and I don't see Dr. Lyle Furch here. I was going to tell him I love him as a brother, but his chosen profession to have a love-hate relationship with. I love to hate it. I had to go to the dentist this last week. I don't do that very well. The dentist and I have never gotten along. And this last week was no exception. Went in for a root canal. I want to tell you that, you know, there's nothing that ranks higher on the not so much fun list than root canals and IRS audits. And I've had enough of both of them. So, anyway, the point I want to make about that, you know, I can tell you how traumatic the experience was for me, so that you all feel sorry for me, and there's nothing wrong with telling me, Pastor, my heart breaks for you. That might make me feel better, but I have a reason for telling you that it was not so much fun. And the reason is this, so listen closely. If you want to see the work the dentist did in my mouth, I would have to open my mouth for your inspection, which I'm not going to do. But even at the end of all of that, he couldn't really see the results of his work. He had to take x-rays and make sure that that tooth that's supposed to have had two roots ended up having four, so I had four root canals done on one tooth. And it was over 2.5 hours. Yeah, I like the halls. So I was there a long time, but there are professions where the work that is done is very obvious and very evident. And I want you to keep that in mind as we walk through the message today. Last Sunday, I began a two-part sermon entitled The Carpenter. It was inspired by a sermon that I read by Dr. Odell Belger on our text. So some of what I shared with you last week and some of what I'll share with you this week comes from that sermon. As we get started today, I want to remind you this fact that I told you last week. There are over 200 names and titles given to Jesus in the Bible. However, for those who knew him best, he was the carpenter. Let me show you what the scripture says. If you'll stand in honor of the reading of God's word, we begin reading again in Mark chapter 6, verse number 1. The scripture says, he went out from thence and came into his own country. This is Jesus coming home. He's been out on his missionary or his ministry journeys, and he comes back home for a while. And his disciples followed him. And when the Sabbath day was come, he began to teach in the synagogue, and many hearing him were astonished, saying, from whence hath this man these things? And what wisdom is this which is given unto him, that even such mighty works are done by his hands? Is not this the carpenter, the son of Mary, the brother of James and Joseph and Judah and Simon? And are not his sisters here with us? And they were offended at him. But Jesus said unto them, a prophet is not without honor, but in his own country, and among his own kin, and in his own house. And he could not there do any mighty work, save that he laid his hands on a few sick folk and healed them. And he marveled because of their unbelief. And he went around about the village. God, we pause for a moment, join our hearts together in prayer to humble ourselves before you, to recognize that you are God and there is none other. I ask, Lord, that you would give me the words that you want me to share today, that you would make and mold me into a vessel fit for your use, that I may be the mouthpiece today that you speak through to deliver your word congregation of people. Would you open our minds to understand what we hear, our hearts to receive with gladness and thanksgiving the precious and powerful Word of God. Father, I pray that all that's done in the coming minutes will be done for your glory and honor. And so, God, thank you for giving us this time together. Bless us with your Spirit as you sweep over this congregation and minister to us individually. Whatever level we need to be ministered to, we trust that you're going to speak to our heart. You're going to encourage us if we need encouragement. You're going to convict us if we need conviction. God, that whatever you do will be done for our benefit and for your glory. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. Let me set the context again. Jesus has returned with his disciples to his own country. The Bible tells us that on the Sabbath day, on the day of worship, he starts teaching in the synagogue. The people are astonished at his teaching and his miracles because they weren't sure where he got the skills to do the miracles, nor the wisdom to teach. In verse 4 and 5 of our text, pretty sad verses. Oftentimes I think we just read over these verses. Keep in mind we have the very Son of God on earth in a ministry, and the scripture says that because of their reaction to him, because of their rejection of him, and I say that because I want to tell you today, you may not like me, but love Jesus. Do not reject the Lord Jesus. It came to a point where the scripture says, that Jesus said to them, a prophet's not without honor, but in his own country, and among his own kin, and in his own house. I think many of you may have experienced that as you got saved and you were excited about your salvation, and the first thing you wanted to do was share it with people that know you best and love you, and when they do, they reject you. They don't want to hear what you have to say. I've listened to personal testimonies and can testify myself that there are folks in my circle of influence that I would love to see impacted by the love of Christ. I would love to see them come to faith. And yet the more you share that with them, the more they reject you. Jesus said that seems to be the case here. He may have had credibility on some level in his active ministry, but when he came home, he didn't have that. And so verse number 5 says that he could do no mighty work amongst his people, amongst his kin, amongst his family, except that he could lay hands on a few sick folk and heal them. The comments and the perplexity of his family and friends as they witnessed what was going on when Jesus came back home during the course of his ministry led to a question. Last week I spent time reviewing the questions that they didn't ask but that they could have asked. And that's in your sermon outlines. You don't have to take this part of the notes, but I will remind you of the questions they didn't ask. They didn't say, is this not the shepherd? Which the Bible tells us that Jesus is a good shepherd that lays down his life for his sheep. He's a great shepherd, which gives life to his sheep. He's a chief shepherd, which rewards his sheep. Is not this a lawyer? And we looked at that last week. Satan constantly accuses us for how we've messed things up and how we're not worthy of anything that God would have for us. But praise God, our worthiness and our righteousness, which the scripture says is as filthy rags, doesn't matter when we've been washed in the blood of the Lamb, because Christ is righteous. But is not this the lawyer? Jesus is our advocate. The Bible tells us in 1 John 2, and I shared that with you, and I put those scripture references in there. Is this not the doctor? They could have said, because there's no greater physician than the Lord Jesus Christ. I shared with you the scripture example of the lady who had a medical issue for 12 years, spent a life savings going to the best known doctor, and none of them could solve her problem. But all she had to do was touch the garment of the Lord Jesus, and she was made whole. Is not this the fisherman? And I talked to you last week about how Jesus speaks in the wind and the sea and the fire and the lion and the fish, and all of creation obeys his voice. And so he told Simon and his brother, you guys been fishing all night, caught nothing? No. Well, here, let me tell you what to do. Go drop your fish, your nets over there. And that's what we fished all night. It's not going to help. But if your word will humor you. So they dropped their nets. And what does the Bible say? They tried to bring those nets up, and they were so full of fish, they started ripping. They started tearing. And so they called for some backup. They called one of the boats close by and said, come over here and help us. We got way too much fish. What? We fished all night, got nothing. Now we've got more fish than we can put in our boat. And they loaded up both boats, and the scripture says the boats began to sink because they couldn't handle the weight of the fish. You see, when Jesus tells the fish to come to school and hang out right here, they obey his voice. Is not this the fisherman? Is not this the Son of God? Could have been another question we talked about last week. And there are many examples in the scripture that Christ demonstrates that he really was the Son of God. At his death, the Roman centurion witnessed all that took place with the earthquake when Jesus bowed his head and said, it's finished, and he gave up the ghost, and the veil and the temple was torn from top to bottom, indicating that it was God that did that. An entry into the throne room, into the presence of Holy God, was now available to us. The centurion, who was just a Roman soldier, said, wow, this was the Son of God. Truly, this was the Son of God. But I want to tell you, I didn't have time to get to this last week, so I'm using it as the springboard into this week's sermon. Not only did all the evidence indicate he was the Son of God, not only did the Roman centurion admit he was the Son of God, but God himself said, this is my Son. In Matthew chapter 3 and verse number 16 and 17, the scripture says, when Jesus was baptized, he went up straightway out of the water. And lo, the heavens were opened unto him, and he saw the Spirit of God. Now I want you to keep in mind, I've shared this fact with you before, this trivia point with you before, so I want to bring it home today. There are two places in Scripture where we actually see the Trinity all together. And this is one of them. Jesus is there, he's baptized. The Spirit of God is there, descending like a dove, and landing on him, alighting on him. And God is there speaking, a voice from heaven, saying, this is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. The other time, we find later in the book of Matthew, on the Mount of Transfiguration, Matthew chapter 17 and verse number 5, while he spoke, behold, a bright cloud overshadowed them. And behold, a voice out of that cloud. And we know that the spirit of Elijah and Moses was there. And God dropped down a cloud. And he spoke out of that cloud. And Jesus, of course, was there. And God said the same thing. This is my beloved Son. So if nothing else testified to the fact that Jesus was the Son of God, his Heavenly Father, our Heavenly Father, said, that is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. I pray that God will say that about me one day. My son, in whom I am well pleased. But the question asked was, is this not the carpenter? Those who knew Jesus best referred to him as a carpenter. Isn't this Joseph's son, the carpenter? Now, it's not uncommon, even today, but especially then, for boys to follow in the footsteps of their fathers with respect to occupation. Because Joseph was a carpenter, it made sense that Jesus would grow up to be a carpenter. And until the age of 30, while he worked at home and while he lived at home, because that was the custom, he worked in a carpenter shop. He was a carpenter. That's how he was known. So why was that his identity amongst those people? Why was that the question? I mean, God could have chosen anyone to be Jesus' mother, and thus have Jesus grow up in a home where the breadwinner had a different occupation than that of a carpenter. But God chose Mary, knowing Joseph's profession, knowing what his occupation would be. And so why did God want his son to be known as a carpenter? In my opinion, I believe that God wanted Jesus to be known as a builder. Carpenters are builders. And what carpenters do, their work is on full display for all to see. Unlike my root canal, what a carpenter does is on display. I've built more than a few houses in my life. The first one I built was for Sarah and I. Let me show you. There's a couple pictures. That's a young pastor. And I want you to see that wood. Does that look like a house? I want you to see the concrete truck in the back. There's where we started on that house. Foreign footings. Go ahead. That's where we put the roof on it, but we had it framed all but the garage. We still had to frame the garage. The next one, I shared with you that Sarah and I lived in a tent for 6 weeks while we got the house framed and enclosed and wired and plumbing, and that tree right there probably causes Rebecca to shiver a little because we're looking down on top of a house that has 9-foot walls. So we're up on the hill, and that tree's up on the hill, and you know brothers and sisters, right? So Matthew and Luke hung up. It was a tire, right, on a rope, and they said to Rebecca, "We're going to swing you out. Trust us." And so we didn't see all this, but they swung her out off a limb off that tree, on that tree there, and their knots let loose, and she went flying, came crashing down on her back, poor girl. And her two dear brothers just laughed at her. The joys of raising children. But that pile of wood is now taking shape. My wife was ready to get out of that tent as soon as we could. 6 weeks later, we had pretty much, we were starting to sheetrock the inside. We'd done that much work. Look at the next picture. That's a happy young pastor's wife. We're inside now. We're not sleeping in the tent. We had the inspector let us bring some mattresses in where they sleep on the floor. In the next picture, that's the finished product. You see what a carpenter does, what a builder does, is they build things for all to see. God wanted his son to be known as a builder, a master builder. So what did Jesus build? Let me go through this real quick with you. Number one, Jesus built the universe. John chapter 1 and verse number 3, the scripture says all things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made. That's pretty cool. Jesus built the universe. Psalm chapter 33, verse number 6, by the word of the Lord. Now remember back in John 1:1, or over in John 1:1, the scripture says that in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And later in that verse we say, we learn that we beheld his glory, speaking of the Word of God, as that of the only begotten of the Father. So the scripture tells us in Psalm that by the word of the Lord were the heavens made, and all the hosts of them by the breath of his mouth. Isn't it awesome to know that when Jesus built the universe, all he had to do was speak it into existence? The very breath of his mouth. Ephesians 3 and verse number 9, to make all men see what is the fellowship of the mystery, which from the beginning of the world has been hid in God, who created all things by Jesus Christ. Praise God, Jesus is a master builder, and he's built the universe. For by him, in Colossians chapter number 1 and verse 16, for by him were all things created that are in heaven, that are in earth, visible and invisible, whether they be thrones or dominions or principalities or powers, all things were created by him and for him. Folks, you and I have been created for the glory of God. Not for our self-satisfaction, not for our happiness, though God gives us much to be satisfied with and allows us to be happy, but we were created for his glory and for his honor. When Jesus built the universe, it was with such skill and such wisdom that astronomers, physicists, biologists, scientists have been studying it for centuries and can't figure it out. They've come up with some very scientific explanations. Something banged into something. It was a big bang. And presto, here we are. And I can have too much fun right here talking about evolution, single cell amoebas, missing links, and so on. But let me just say this, and I'll move on. The fool has said in his heart, there is no God. You cannot look at creation and not see God in it. You know what it would be like? I'm going to say this real quick. It would be like that house that you just saw, that first one that we built. It would be like the electrical speaking to the plumbing and say, how did we get here? Oh, I don't know. I guess we just crashed into each other and here we are. The plumbing saying to the framing, how did we get here? I don't know. I think somebody stuck a board up, or there was a board here and it's evolved to the next board, to the next board, and suddenly we had a wall, and then we had another wall. And those walls saying to the foundation, what's this all about? You see, the point I'm trying to make is creation has to be done by someone outside of what's created. There has to be a creator. When I was standing in that first frame talking with Perry, saying, look, this is what we're going to do. This is what the plans show us. We have a plan and we're going to follow it. The fool has said in his heart, there is no God. Genesis 1:1 says, in the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. God is outside of time. There is no beginning and no end to God. We can't explain God, and if we're trying to figure out How we got here, apart from God, we're fooled. Revelation 4:11 says that you're worthy, O Lord, to receive glory and honor and power, because you've created all things, and for your pleasure, they are and were created. Our purpose is to please God. For His pleasure, we were created. Jesus built the universe. Number two, Jesus built the New Testament church. We're living in trying times. Many say it's perilous in the last days. There seems to be an all-out assault on Christianity. A recent Pew Research study shows that by 2050, Christianity and Christians will be a minority in America. A nation that was founded on Christian principles, a nation that was founded on the pursuit of religious expression, religious liberty, that was predominantly Christian and has been for well over 200 years, is in danger of becoming the minority. And according to these new studies coming out, by 2015 or 2050, that will be the case. Why? Because everything that the Bible says is right, society is now saying it's wrong, and vice versa. And so we've turned our back on God, and we've turned our back on God's Word, and we cannot be surprised when we find that Satan is going to pound us down and beat us up. Folks, we got to take a stand on the Word of God, even when it's unpopular in our current society, in our current culture. Churches are shrinking in number, because church growth experts are telling them that they need to put coffee bars in McDonald's restaurants in their churches, and by doing that, they're going to get people to church. I believe that Jesus built the New Testament church not on egg McMuffins and whatever those latte things are. He built it on the Word of God. And as long as we preach the Word of God, the church will grow. The Bible says in Matthew chapter 16 and verse number 18, Jesus said, I'll build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. It is as though the church is already, many churches have started throwing in the towel and believing they have to do something other than what the Bible says about going, ye therefore, into all the world and spread the gospel. They begin to think that we have to do something different. Jesus said, I'm going to build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. Don't you think we can trust that promise? There's nothing that Satan can do to snuff out the church of God. I shared with the deacons the other night when John was swatting a fly. I said, you know, it seems to me like every time I swat a fly and kill it, three come to its funeral. You just can't get rid of those things. And it dawns on me that Satan can kill one of us, but 10 of us are going to show up to the funeral. It doesn't matter what Satan does. I want you to understand what I'm saying. It doesn't matter what Satan does. He will not snuff out the church of the living God, because Jesus said, I'll build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. He's building his church. Why is that the case? Because he's building his church out of saints. He's not building his church out of wood, out of concrete, out of steel. We very much appreciate a nice place to meet. But I got to tell you, even if this building was not standing here, the saints can still gather together, because we are the church of the living God. How do I know that? I'm glad you asked. The Bible tells us in Ephesians chapter 2 and verse number 18 to 22. Now therefore, you are no more strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens with the saints. Dude, we are, can I say dude? I think I can. We are citizens with each other. You are fellow citizens with the state, or with the saints, and of the household of God. And we are being carried protectively in the hand of God. And you're built upon the foundation of the apostles and the prophets, Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone. Dude, how can Satan prevail against that? In whom all the building, fitly framed together, grows into a holy temple in the Lord. Dude, we have to protect that. That ought to get you a little excited this morning. In whom you also are built together for a habitation of God through the Spirit. The building of the house that you just saw a few minutes ago, just like every house that we ever build, begins with a perfect right angle. Because if you do not have a perfect right angle, your walls are going to run off in different directions. If you don't know how to plumb a wall, everything's going to look squirrely. So you begin with something you learned a long time ago in geometry, and this is not a geometry class, but I tell you, if any of you guys are trying to put a deck on your house or build something, let me say, start with a right angle. A squared plus B squared equals C squared. What do I mean? 3 squared is 9. 4 squared is 16. So if you measure 3 feet or 30 feet, it doesn't matter. You measure the other way, 4 or 40 feet, it doesn't matter. The hypotenuse of that has to be 5 or 5 squared. That'll make a perfect right angle. So 3 squared is 9, 4 squared is 16, and what is 5 squared? 25. What is 9 plus 16? 25 for those of you who are struggling. So if you measure 3 feet and 4 feet, and then it should be 5 feet from this point to that point. If not, you adjust the line so that it becomes 5. And 3 squared plus 4 squared equals 5 squared, you're going to have a perfect right angle. And that's where you take off. Jesus is the perfect right angle. The Bible calls him the cornerstone. Jesus is building a church, according to the scriptures we just read, with all of us fitting together perfectly. And here's the good news in these distressing days and perilous times. The building that Jesus builds, no earthquake can crumble, No tornado will blow us away. No hurricane will flood us. And get ready for this. The gates of hell will not prevail against us. We are the church of the living God, built by the master builder. That's a hallelujah moment right there. Number 3, Jesus built the roadway to a new life. If we are honest, living the Christian life is difficult in our current society, in our current cultures. Those friends and family members that are not saved have turned their back on you, probably, just like they did Jesus. The Bible says that they were embarrassed by him. Can you imagine being embarrassed by Jesus? Dude, what's wrong with you? they turn their back on you. Just like your friends and family, they turn their back on you. They may do things like accusing you of being better than them, because you're just trying to share with them the good news. And suddenly they say, oh, you're just one of those holy brokers. You live your life like you're self-righteous, good word, sinners, just like you. The difference is we've been saved by grace. So we want to introduce you to the grace of God and to the salvation of our Lord. They might say you're out of touch with reality, that you need to accept societal trends and cultural shifts. Staying in that fight, living that Christian life, can be exhausting. But listen, if we are in Christ, if we have come to faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, we are a new person. And the master builder of new lives gives us a way to stay the course with the needed endurance. How do we do that? When we're tired and when we're fatigued, when Satan is whispering in our ear that we're losers, when all those around us have begun to reject us, how do we stay the course? We need to understand that we can't stay the course on our own. We can't. So, preacher, what do? We claim the promises of God's word. Jesus said in Matthew, the 11th chapter, and verse number 28 through 30, he said, come to me, all you that labor and are heavy laden. I'll give you rest. That's a pretty awesome promise, don't you think? Jesus said, come to me. Dude, you don't have to carry it on your own. Quit trying to bear a burden you cannot bear alone. Jesus said, take my yoke upon you and learn of me. Have you ever seen a team of oxen or horses pulling a plow? You have to yoke them together. Otherwise, they won't pull the plow together. So when Jesus talks about putting on a yoke, he says, listen, I'm on the other side. We're going to pull this load together. And I want to tell you that with the strength and the power and the presence of Jesus Christ, we can pull any plow that is hitched up to us. Come unto me, all you that labor and are heavy laden, I'll give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and you shall find rest unto your soul. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Put me in the yoke with the Lord Jesus, and I'll be able to finish the race, finish my course. I can't do it on my own. You can't do it on your own. But with the Lord Jesus, you can't fail. He builds new lives. Let me tell you something else. All of us wish that we could turn the hands of time back and undo something that we did, or do something that we didn't do, or unsay something that we said. Isn't it true that our words are so damaging and so hurting? And once those words are gone, the damage is done. How we all wish we could turn the hands of time back and not say that or do that. We look across the landscape of our life and we become acutely aware of how bad we've messed up. We couple that with Satan sitting on our shoulder and constantly whispering into our ear what a loser we are. And then to make matters even worse, the Bible tells us that Satan is constantly bugging God about our sin, accusing us day and night before God. Why would Jesus want to yoke up with us. I'm going to tell you why. If you were here last week, you'd understand what I'm about to say. Get the dingers ready. Revelation chapter 12 and verse number 10, the scripture says, I heard a loud voice saying in heaven, now is come salvation and strength and the kingdom of our God and the power of his Christ. For the accuser of our brethren is cast down, which accused them before our God day and night. What's the scripture saying there? The scripture saying that Jesus whoops up on Satan. And I love it when Satan gets beat up. You know, I was thinking about this yesterday as I was reviewing my notes. I thought, I wonder if they're going to, like, you know, start throwing punches. And Jesus is going to hit him with a knockout shot and away he goes. We receive salvation and strength and power in the kingdom of God, and Satan goes to hell. Now, if that doesn't ring your bell, then your dinger's broke. Second Corinthians chapter 5 and verse number 17, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things have passed away, and behold, all things have become new. Jesus builds new lives. He takes your stress, he takes your burden, he yokes up with you, he beats Satan up, he gives us victory. Well, I could go on and on and on. To God be the glory. Amen. Great things he's done. Amen. In Christ Jesus. And we are the benefactor of his grace and his blessing and his love and his forgiveness and his salvation. And on we can go. God has opened up the windows of heaven and poured out blessings greater than we can imagine or even greater than we can enumerate or articulate. Because when you come to faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, he's got you. He's got you safe and secure. He's got his arms around you, and he's got you in the palm of his hand. He says, you're safe. You're mine. And I got you protected. Number four, Jesus built a pathway to God. In John 14, 6, the Bible says, Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. Let me pause for a moment to say there are many different thoughts, schools of thought, teaching out there that says if you live good enough, if you give enough money, you can find your way to heaven. Jesus said, there is no way to the Father but by me. And you never will be introduced to the Lord Jesus until you go to Calvary. And in Calvary, you have to repent of your sin. You have to agree with God that you're a sinner. You have to say, Lord, I messed up. David said in Psalm 51, against you, Lord, and you only have I done this horrible thing. If you never have come to a place where you've owned your sin and confessed it before a holy God, you have never come to a point and place where you've been saved. Because there where you do that, there at that moment, when you confess your sin, when you repent, Jesus will restore you and reconcile you and redeem you. But none of that happens until you confess your sins to a holy God. You're not going to grow into salvation. You're not going to get it by osmosis. You're not going to get it because you've been in church all your life. You need to, with a broken heart and a contrite spirit, according to Scripture, bow before holy God and say, I'm sorry. I'm sorry for what I did. I'm not blaming it on anybody else. I'm not shifting it to someone or something. God, I'm owning my sin. I am a sinner. I am. As are you. But when you come to Christ, your sins are forgiven. Does it mean you're no longer identified as a sinner. Yeah, I'm a sinner. And I'm still, while I'm in this fleshly, weak body, I'm still going to sin. We don't do that so that grace may abound. But the difference is, my soul has been saved. My body is still going to die because it's still subject to sin. And I don't want to go too far down this road, but you need to understand that the Bible tells us when God created us, He breathed into our nostrils the breath of life. And what does it say? Man became a living soul. That's what God is interested in, is your soul's condition. And that's what He gives life to here, when we confess our sin. And that's why when we die, our spirit leaves us. And one day, if we have been saved by the blood of the Lord Jesus, that spirit will receive a new and glorified body that's no longer subject to sin. His old dead body is just going to rot in the ground. We need to understand that we may still struggle with the same battles. We may have guilt. We may have Satan whispering in our ear. We may have Satan constantly trying to disarm us and disable us. We need to focus on what God did for us. And if you can't identify a time in your life where God did a miraculous work in your life, then I challenge you today to go to Calvary. Go to Calvary and see a beaten, battered, bloody Savior on the cross paying the price for your sin. Jesus has built a pathway to God. I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. You know, when I was talking to my son-in-law, he approached me asking for my daughter's hand. Now, let me say two things here. Number one, dads, when somebody wants your daughter's hand, you better drill them and put them through the third degree. That's Jeff Glass over there. Because I had to get the things most important to me out of the way. I said to him, you need to know that I've spent her whole life taking care of her. And I will hurt anybody that hurts her. That's a great way to start a conversation. And he said, I'm smarter than to get sideways with you and Matthew and Luke. Okay, what do you want to talk about? And we went from there. And I said, tell me about your salvation. And he shared with me that his father had been trying to influence him to go to church, go to a men's Bible study. And he just pulled him off. Just like Jesus said, a prophet's not without honor. Here he has a dad that loves him, and he's rejecting the message. And so he's kind of on the run, and he signs on to work on a commercial fishing boat. They're out to sea for 45 days. And in the course of that time, he gets pretty seriously injured. No doctor on the ship, and they're not coming back in. His leg is seriously infected. He's got a fever. His foot is so swollen that he said it took a half hour to get his shoe off and on. Went to the captain, and the captain basically said, too bad, we're all working. He came to a place, I'm going to go quickly, but he came to a place where he thought that these guys might throw me overboard. was scared. And he didn't know if he died there in that ship, he was where he would spend eternity. He didn't know that. He didn't even remember what has happened. And he cried out to Christ for salvation. And he told me last night, and I asked him to remind me of the story so I had the details right. He said, I didn't cry out for God to take the infection away. I didn't ask him to heal my physical leg and foot. I asked him to save me. And I know at that moment God saved me. And I said, okay, you can marry my daughter. But here's the rest of the story. He said the very next morning, there was no medicine, nothing. He was in bad shape. The very next morning, when he woke up, the infection was almost half gone. And within a few days, it was all gone. You see, sometimes God has to get our attention. He has to knock us down to lift us up. He has to bring us to a point and place in our life where we say, I am desperate and destitute and destined for hell apart from the Lord Jesus. And so the second part of what I was going to say, and then I'm going to jump back here, the dads, make sure that anybody who wants your daughter's hand in marriage speaks to you first. If they don't have the courage to talk to you, they don't need your daughter's hand in marriage. Yeah. And number two, teach your sons to be man enough to talk to the father of the girl they're interested in marrying. Teach them to have that kind of courage, that kind of manhood. So guess what happened? In Jeff's case, he experienced the same truth that everyone who calls out to Christ for salvation experiences. And that is that the Lord Jesus hears your prayer and answers it. The Bible tells us in Romans, the 10th chapter, verse number 13, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Now that is just a simple promise that we can trust. You might be in the gutter of life. Some of the things that was going on in his life, he probably didn't tell me because he might not want me to know. But God changes us. You can be in the gutter of life. You can be the guttermost. And God makes you the uppermost. Because Christ saves you to the uttermost. That sounds pretty profound. And then I don't say too many profound things. Let me say that again. You may be the guttermost. God will make you the uppermost. Because Christ saves you to the uttermost. And so, we claim what Christ said in John chapter 10 in verse number 9. He says, I'm the door. If any man enters in, he shall be saved. Isn't that great? Ephesians 2 in verse number 18, for through him we both, meaning Christ and us, have access by one Spirit unto the Father. You see, Jesus saves us to the uttermost. So that when he goes into the presence of God, so can we. And he can tell his heavenly Father, this old preacher boy, has been washed in the blood. And the Father can say, this is my Son, in whom I'm well pleased. Praise God for salvation. The master builder built a pathway to God. Lastly, number 5, Jesus built the gateway to the New Jerusalem. In John chapter 14, Jesus says, beginning verse number 1, let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you, and if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also. I wish I had time to really unpack all of this. Let me hit a couple of highlights. Can you imagine if the master builder built the whole universe, the world, and all that's in it in 6 days? Can you imagine what your mansion in heaven's going to look like when you've been working on it for over 2,000 years? Let that sink in. The Bible tells us that we can't even know, we can't even imagine what God has in store for us. In 1 Corinthians chapter 2 and verse number 9, God, what's my mansion going to look like? What's heaven going to look like? Eye has not seen, nor ear heard, nor has entered into the heart of man the things which God has prepared for them that love him. My goodness. We got something coming at us that we have no way to even imagine. Can you imagine that? Is that correct? What he's doing for us. Jesus said he's coming again to get us. And guess what? God gives us a glimpse of what heaven's going to be like through the Apostle John. In Revelation chapter 21, beginning in verse number 2, the scripture says, John says, I, John, saw the holy city, the New Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, behold, the tabernacle of God. Remember earlier I told you that Jesus is building us into a tabernacle? And he says, I behold the tabernacle, saying, behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them. And they shall be his people, and God shall dwell with them, and he will be their God. And listen to this, Brother Pete. God will wipe away all the tears from their eyes, and there will be no more death, neither sorrow, nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain. There's not going to be any sickness, for the former things are passed away. And he that sat upon the throne said, behold, I make all things new. And he said unto me, write, for these words are true and faithful. John says, I was told to write these words down. Folks, the day is coming when there will be no more pain, no more sickness, no more sadness, no more sorrow. All those things have passed away. No more death, no more crying. Isn't it going to be great when your heart's no longer broken and you are no longer shedding tears of sorrow? Behold, I make all things new. And he said unto me, write, for these words are true and faithful. And the city had no need of the sun, neither of the moon to shine in it. Listen to this. For the glory of God did lighten it. And the Lamb is the light thereof. Is not this the carpenter? Yes, it is. Jesus, the master builder. The world, your friends, your co-workers, even your family may have given up on you, but the master builder will recycle you. And he will build a whole new life out of the mess you've made. Why wouldn't you come to Jesus? Day's coming when heaven will come down and glory will fill our soul. But I'm throwing you a curveball, but that's what I want to say. Heavenly Fathers, thank you for your word. Thank you for how it speaks. God, we're so blessed to be able to open up the precious, inspired, infallible, inerrant, all-sufficient Word of God. We are blessed that you have given us your Word in written form, even in living form, when Jesus was here. So God, I pray that this message has spoken to the hearts of the people as it did mine, that you allow me the privilege of preparing this message. I pray, Lord, that people will take in what they've heard today. Maybe they just need to rejoice. Say thank you for allowing me to be your child. Maybe they need to confess. Maybe they need to own their sin. Maybe they need to come to the cross and come to faith in Christ. God, I believe that your word goes forth as you said. It accomplishes what you wanted to accomplish. It doesn't come back to you having failed in any way. So for those here where your word needs to drill deep into their heart and bring them to a place of salvation, allow that to happen. For those who feel a conviction and they know that their life is not really in step with you and they need to get in step with you, help them to take this time to do that now. Lord, there may be others who are looking for a church home, and this is the place you're leading them to get in and become a part of the church family here. Whatever it is that you desire to do in these next few moments, we trust that you'll do it for your glory and honor. And so we thank you for this time together. In Jesus' name, amen.